Hello, everybody. I'm going to give what I hope is a very elementary talk, so you know, you'll probably be very bored. But for those of you who don't know this or have forgotten a little bit, I'm just going to go over the problem of regularization and explain the traditional methods for dealing with it a little bit. So the question is this. We have a symplectic manifold. And it's got an almost complex structure J, which is omega tame. And we're looking at J holomorphic curves. Now, to be simple, I'm just going to think of the domain being a sphere, so I'm going to write, say, M tilde top 0k of, well, decorated by all these things, J A, say, which is going to be the set of maps. Now, I'm just going to take the sphere as my domain into M, which are J holomorphic, which represent the class A. So that's a class in the second homology of M. I'm going to have some marked points, Z1 through ZK, which it just underlines Z. And these points are different. And that's just a space of J holomorphic maps. So these elements are maps, and the tilde means that the elements are maps. Now, does everybody know what all these words mean? Because I'm just assuming you do. And if you don't, please ask, okay? It's up to you. And then we're interested in this space, but also we're interested in, if you've got two of these elements, U, Z, we can say one element is equivalent to another element, U prime, Z prime, if there's a diagram of this kind. So we've got phi from S2 to S2, which is, phi is a Namurbius group. So that's a biholomorphic map. We've got U going there to M. We've got U prime going there, and the diagram's meant to commute, and say we've got Z prime there, and that goes to phi Z. Right. So this would be something of the form U prime would be phi composed with U, and this would be phi inverse of Z. Okay, so we have this equivalence relation. And we're not interested really in the space of actual maps. We're more interested in the space of equivalence classes of maps. So that's going to be written as M top 0k. So that's going to be M tilde top 0k, divided out by this equivalence relation. So these are equivalence classes. So we're not really interested so much in the way they're parameterized, just that they have a parameterization. We're interested in the images, the geometric images in M. And I've put top here because this is the top strata of some completed space. Okay. So in the best case, this M tilde top 0k of MJA is a smooth manifold transversally cut out what that means is that the Cauchy-Riemann operator is zero, so del bar J of U is a half of du composed with plus j, du composed with little j. So that's a Cauchy-Riemann operator. And so this is a zero set, an operator. And if you're saying it's transversely cut out, you mean that the derivative of the operator is surjective. I'm going to say more about that later on. But anyway, you want it to be transversely cut out. And the dimension of this thing then would be equal to the index of the operator is 2 n plus 2c1 of a plus 2k, which is the number of marked points, because they're varying in a two-dimensional space. So that's the dimension. And why you want it to be transversely cut out is that there's a Fredholm theory, and that means that if you vary J, the space is not going to change very much. Okay? So that's the sort of basic space of J holomorphic maps. And so in the best case, the first situation is that this is a nice manifold. And then, as I say, what we're really interested in is the quotient space. So this is M top. That this is, it's almost never compact, but it's compact enough. And why this space is almost never compact? You can see that it's almost never compact, because for one thing, I'm insisting I've got these points z1 through zk, and they're meant to be all different from each other. So two of them could come together, and of course that would not be in this space. And then another problem about the compactness is that this group of equivalences, this group here, PSL2C, is not a compact group. So that means you're quotienting out by something which is not compact, and that can cause problems. But what do I mean by compact enough? Well, sort of for the purposes it's compact. So what are the purposes? Well, we're interested in the evaluation map from M tilde, well, really from M top now. And let me, well, M A, sorry. Just put an A in there. Mapping to M to the K. So we've got a pair UZ, which is an equivalence class, so I can put brackets like that, going to U evaluated at Z1 up to U evaluated at ZK. And that, of course, is defined on the space of maps, but it maps through the quotient. So there's a well-defined map here. And what you want for this is, you want the image, so that it to represent a homology class. And for that, you see, if this were a compact manifold, then of course it would have a fundamental class, so you could just look at the push forward of that fundamental class. But in fact, for it to represent a homology class, it doesn't have to have a compact image. What it needs is that the IE, if you look at the closure of the image, so this is the image of the evaluation map minus the image itself. So this is the boundary of the image. This should have codimension at least 2. So that means what we say is it represents a pseudocycle. And to give you an example, well, let's take the very simplest example. It's what I think is a really simple example. Take the projective plane with a standard J and the class to be the class of a line. And then C1, the first Chern class of the line, is 3. And so the dimension of M, if we take 2 mark points, the dimension here is going to be it's 2n plus 2c1 of A plus 2k, which is 4, and then minus 6, which is the dimension of the reparameterization group that I've quotient it out by. Okay, so this is the dimension of PSL2C, the Möbius group. And this is 6, and this is 4, and so we get 8. And that, of course, is the same as the dimension of, if we take CP2 times CP2. So if we look at the evaluation map from M top 0, 2 in the class of a line going to CP2 times CP2, we have UZ goes to UZ1, UZ2, And what this is, remember, these things represent a line. And so this is the elements here represent, you've got an S2, you've got two points on it, which in fact we can normalize. We can take the first one to be at zero and the second one to be at infinity, say, because the group is triply transitive. So we can fix these two points. And then we've still got an action of C star acting on these things. So this is M tilde top with a fixed point at zero and infinity and quotiented out by C star. So it's still something, a space of maps quotiented out by a non-compact group. And anyway, you've got this space of maps. You're looking at where they go. So you've got two points in CP2. And you sort of take the line through them. Well, there's a unique line through any two points. Therefore, this map is injective. If we take the standard complex structure, we know that that's injective. But of course, it's not surjective. And you can see it's not surjective because the two points it's going through are different. They have to be different because I'm assumed that these two points are different. They're not allowed to come together. So the image is equal to CP2 times CP2 minus the diagonal, right? Very clearly. So it's not a compact image. You can see this space is not compact. On the other hand, the set of maps is somehow compact. That's by Gromov's theorem. And you can compactify this. I mean, this diagonal has codimension 2. It's real codimension 4, I suppose, because it's where these two points, it's a diagonal here. And so it does represent a pseudocycle. It does represent a fundamental class because the image of the boundary is so small.
Just to understand the words, codimension of these two means inside the closure of the image or inside the ambient?
Inside the, in M to the K. So we're looking, I mean, this is, the, so we're not talking about the structure of the domain here. Which is, I mean, in good cases, you can assume it's a manifold, but it's not going to be compact, usually. But you're saying, so this, it's a non-compact manifold. But if you look at its image in here, it has a fundamental class because the boundary is so small.
Now, is that really the codimensional condition one? Or the wave MK is some huge thing?
Yeah, what? Codimension in the closure. Yeah.
Well, it's a codimension, it's a real codimension of at least 2 in M to the K, so whatever dimension that has. So in this case, I mean, what's wrong with it?
Makes sense. What if M to the K was an enormous thing, and this was like one curve? We really care about the closure.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Yeah, okay, so what do I mean by, so I'm saying this incorrectly. What I mean is that the boundary of the image minus the image should be a union of maps from some manifolds V. So V, this is some finite union, say. And the dimension of V should be less than or equal to the dimension of our original space, M top, minus 2. That's what I mean. I'm sorry. You're right. Right. That makes sense. So it's codimension. It means it should have at least 2 dimensions less than the dimension of the image.
And this is assuming M top has the expected dimension?
That's assuming that M top has the expected dimension, which it's going to have if it's a... That was my first assumption, that it's a transversely cut-out manifold, so of the right dimension. So it means that means it has a correct dimension, and then right that you're assuming that this is meant to represent a homology class of the right dimension, the dimension of the index. That's okay now. Okay. So now, let's say so there are several things here. I mean, the regularity problem is the problem of arranging the first thing that it's transversely cut out, to find if you could find a J to make it a nice manifold. That's the regularity problem. But then there's also the compactness problem, that you want to make sure that this image is compact enough. Well, how can you make sure about that? Now, the compactness is actually much easier to deal with than the regularity, so let me just say a few words about compactness. So there's Gromov's compactness theorem, which tells you that if you have a, you know, you look at this, these are sequences of spheres, right? And you look at these are spheres in M. Perhaps I should go to a different book. So we have these. So we've got some curves UK, say, from say S2 into M. We've got a sequence of curves. And they're in a fixed homology class. And so that means then that the pullback of omega on the S2 is fixed. It's omega of A, the integral. And this is actually analytically, it's the energy. It's equal to, I'll probably get the formula wrong, but pullback of du squared over S2. That's the energy of u. So it's basically the L2 norm of u, measured with respect to the correct. I mean, you have to choose a metric on there and stuff, measure it with the correct things, and you get this is the energy. So this is a sequence of curves. So these are C infinity maps, the holomorphic curves, and they have bounded L2 norm. Well, they're actually W12 norm. This is the L2 norm of the first derivative. So this is what's called the it's a sort of boundary case. If we had, because these are holomorphic, the holomorphic maps on a two-dimensional space, if it were a bounded W1p norm for p bigger than 2, then there's standard sort of compactness arguments that tell you there would be a compact subsequence. Or a convergent subsequence. That's just standard elliptic theory. And why the W1p norm, where p is bigger than 2, is because this norm, if you have something bounded in W1p norm, that controls the C0 norm. So that means it's an equicontinuous family in the C0 norm. So you use sort of standard results about equicontinuity to extract a convergent subsequence. But what we have is this borderline case where it's a 2, not bigger than 2. So in fact, it's possible for this thing not to have a convergent subsequence. But if it doesn't have a convergent subsequence, what's happening is that the energy is somehow concentrating near a point, and you can rescale it and get a convergent subsequence. So that comes down to the fact that, for example, in this case here, we're quotienting out even here by a non-compact group. That's a non-compact group there. And so that sort of affects the convergence. But anyway, this is really well understood. And what Gromov proved was that there exists a subsequence, you also call UK, say, that converges to, well, what Gromov called a cusp curve, or what we now call stable map. And what a stable map is, you see, bubbles can develop. I'll explain a little bit in this case later on, but what it's going to be is the domain now, sigma, is a nodal sphere. So it's going to be a union of spheres joined at points. So it could look like this. It could be a bubbles, you know, a set of spheres like that. That would be the domain. There'd be some marked points on here, where, because your marked points would converge somewhere. Suppose we've got three marked points. They converge somewhere like that. And the map, U, would then map each component into M. So you'd have a sequence of, you'd have a set of maps. And that's what, so, for example, just suppose we were looking at a map from S2 into CP2, which had degree 2. So that would be a quadric. but a quadric can degenerate into two lines. So that's in class 2a. That's one degeneration that could happen. You can have, so that's a geometric degeneration where you have a sequence of things representing a quadric which degenerates to two lines. But you could also have a degeneration that happens because, for example, suppose you're in this case and the marked points come together. Well, the marked points are not allowed to come together here. If they do come together, then you could have a situation like this where you actually have a bubble and that bubble contains both marked points. And here, this is what's called a ghost component, in the sense that the map U restricted to this component is constant. So what you have here is a situation where you have this ghost, this is a line, so you've got a map of a line, and your two marked points are sitting in the domain in this sphere, which is called a ghost component. So I should give you a proper definition of a stable map so you can see you can put these all together into the space of stable maps. Now, is there any way of retrieving that board? Ah, wait a minute. What about this? No. It's got a very tall person. There's a rod.
In between the two.
Ah, this thing.
I don't know.
Doesn't have a. I don't know. What's. Oh, well, this is it. This is it. This one's got a hook. Okay. That's good enough. Oh, look, it's going up by itself. Ah! Very obedient. Okay.
When the most points you integrate, like the thing you integrate for the energy, do you develop poles there, or is it just the same?
Well, no, the energy just comes from the map, so it doesn't see it doesn't see where the marked points are. But I wanted to give you a definition of a stable map, and of course these can occur in any genus. They don't have to be genus zero. I was just restricting to genus zero for simplicity. But so let's just do genus zero, because the point about genus zero is that then you can think of your domain as a union of these two spheres, and each two sphere you can parameterize in a nice way and give it the standard complex structure. So you don't have to worry about variations of the complex structure on the domain. Typically, you'd have a nodal surface, which you'd have to allow the complex structure on the surface to vary in tachymal space. You can put that in if you want, but let's just make it simple. So it's a nodal Riemann surface. So you have something, and it's meant to, you know, you can have something like that, but it's meant to be connected in a tree diagram. So you're not allowed to have something like this. That would have genus. That would be a genus one thing. So it's a tree, it's a tree here, a labeled tree, and you have a certain set of marked points. You sprinkle your points around, because we've got five marked points. You could sprinkle them around like that. The marked points are all distinct. And so they're on particular spheres, so you have to say which sphere they're on. Then you have some maps, U, which is a one map for each component. And so we have, so we're looking at tuples, which is a form sigma. Complex structure is understood here, Z, U. And then you put an equivalence relation. Well, the obvious equivalence relation that just like I had before, you just have some holomorphic, this is a holomorphic map here. So you're interested in these modulo reparameterization. And then there's an all-important stability condition. Now, you don't need to, when you're talking about a stable map, U doesn't have to be holomorphic. I mean, eventually we're interested in the holomorphic ones, but in general you can just look at arbitrary maps with nodal domains like this. But it's very important to have a stability condition, and what that is telling you, this is equivalent to saying that for each element, if you have sigma JU and you look at the group of automorphisms, so it maps of that to itself, this is finite. So you don't allow yourself to have an infinite number of automorphisms. And what that means is, now if say on a component like this component, the map is non-constant, then the map is either injective or it's some multiple covering, and there could only be a finite number of automorphisms of that component. So if you have a component where the map is non-constant, there's no condition. But if you have a component, if the map U were constant here, then you see, what would an automorphism of this thing be? Well, it would have to fix Z0, Z1. It would have to fix this nodal point. But you see, if we've only got two, what are called special points, we've only got two special points on this component. There's a mark point and there's the nodal point. And so there, in principle, is a one complex parameter family of automorphisms of this thing. So that would not be allowed. So the claim is that if U alpha restricted to the alphath component is constant, S alpha to alpha has at least three special points. And special points are nodal points or mark points. That's the important condition. So that means, for example, in this particular case, I could allow that to be, that could be a ghost component. So that one could be a ghost component. This one could be a ghost component. This one's not allowed to because it's only got two mark points. That one couldn't be. So this would be a possible degeneration. If you were looking at maps, say, from U from S2 to CP2 of degree 2, so that these are in the class twice a line, then this one could represent a line, that one could represent a line, and we've got five mark points. That would be a perfectly good stable map of this kind. And the claim is that if you look, so we define M bar 0k MJA to be the equivalence classes of stable maps in genus 0. So this is a genus thing. And K mark points. And representing the class A. And if you've got a J there, they're J holomorphic. Okay, so that's the space of J holomorphic stable maps. And it could be, it's a stratified space. I mean, why I wrote top there is that top was its top component, if you like, where its domain just had a smooth sphere. But then it has all these other components where the domains are nodal curves. And some of them, if you like, are sort of artificial. Like this is an artificial one because the two mark points have come together. And so, you know, nearby things to this would be something where you had a and then you had, so this would still be constant, say, this one could have a Z2 on it, but now we'd have three mark points on that component. So, and then when these two mark points come together, we'd have this bubble sort of artificially created in the domain. This was Kontsevich's idea, the way of describing what's happening, way of describing the compactification. So the claim is that we have this, this space here, this is compact. It's a compact space. And if everything is regular, so in other words, if all the underlying maps, it, you see, a regular thing would be, for this would be that this map was a J-holomorphic map, transversely cut out, which I'm going to say more about later, so is that. And then all these intersections here, you've got a space of spheres here, a space of spheres here, these are kind of constant maps. All these intersections are meant to be transverse, so that it all sort of comes out and it's all in the right dimension. And the strata, the formal dimension, if you like, of the strata is equal to the dimension of the original, of the top space, minus twice the number of nodes. So each node gives you, contributes sort of a codimension two to the thing. And that's a formal dimension, that's the index. So that means that if you can arrange everything to be trans, you know, all the things are transverse, that will be the dimension that it has. But it, of course, it doesn't have to be like that. But if it were, then you see, if you're in a situation like this, where you can arrange that all the lower strata have basically have the right dimension, then the top thing of this will represent a pseudocycle, because this is compact. So you can compactify the image of the map by just looking at the image of these things, and then the boundary of it is going to be covered by the images of the higher dimension of the strata, you know, the higher codimension strata here, and they're all going to have at least codimension two. So that's a sort of standard regularization picture, that you compactify the image by putting in the images of the evaluation maps from the strata and this in this space of stable maps. If you can arrange, if you can control our dimensions reasonably, then they all have the codimension at least two, and then you get a pseudocycle. Now, of course, the kicker is that you can't always control a dimension. That's the whole problem. But if you could, you'd solve this problem. You'd have got, I mean, because our aim, of course, is to try and use these spaces of maps to get some invariants. We want to get these homology classes out that we can then intersect and get the Gromov-Witten invariants or something. And this is just for closed curves, but if you're doing open curves, you have boundaries and you put boundary conditions on. The formal structure is exactly the same. The equation looks a little bit more complicated because you have to deal with what happens at the near the, you know, the near the non-compact parts of the domain. But formally, it's exactly this idea, that you can always compactify the space you're looking at by making some space of stable maps or stable buildings or something. And then you just need to control the dimensions. In principle, all the boundary components you've added should have codimension at least two. You need to control that, make sure it does. Okay? So that's telling you all I was going to say about compactness. But you see, I must have erased. Yeah, here I erased the first condition, which was that everything was transversely cut out. That's what I need to talk about, because that's the hard thing. The compactness is sort of understood.
Yeah. Why don't you have to worry about the unstable maps? Like, why aren't they somewhere in the...
Well, the unstable maps would be... Well, the thing is that they don't appear in the compactification, because if you have an unstable component, suppose that were an unstable component, so that map was constant, then you could just forget about that bubble and put that point there. You see, the unstable components are things which don't actually contribute to the image because the map on them is zero. It's just a constant map. And so you can just collapse any unstable components. And the thing is that it's, I mean, that's a good question.
I didn't understand. Can you say again?
Yeah, I'm saying that suppose we had this situation, but this sphere, it was a constant map there. Then that would be an unstable component. But the thing is that so I'm saying that that's not going to be in the compactification because we don't allow that in the compactification. What we do is, in that particular case, we just get rid of that completely and just put the mark point there, and there wouldn't be a bubble there at all. Because the image would be the same.
If you have like a sequence, I mean, like in your top stratum, like you can just define it so that it like converges to a stable map, like with the stability condition.
When you look at the compactness argument, what's happening when a bubble forms, in this particular case, if this is what we had, all that would have happened here is that some of the mark points would have come together. And the underlying map here, you just have a sequence of maps which was basically converging to a map. And all that would have happened to create this set of bubbles is that the mark points would have come together in a particular way, sort of these two points coming together first and then these two points coming together second, and then they would form this bubble. And you can actually see that completely clearly just by sort of rescaling and blowing up and looking at, you know, nearby this, you'd have here would be the point where you'd be rescaling. This point is going to go into these bubbles. You'd have a Z4 and Z5 very, very close. And then sort of further away, you'd have a Z2 and Z3. So there'd be two scales of bubbling here. This would be these ones would be the furthest ones, and these ones would be the later ones. But the map itself would be constant. So the map to M would be constant, but you're talking about how the mark points are coming together. And it turns out, we've proved this inexhaustively in our book on J-homomorphic curves with Dietmar. If you just look at the way you prove the compactness, you can get, you could describe the, of course you could put in something like that and allow that as a limit, but then you wouldn't have a sort of unique limit. And it doesn't give you a good structure. This was Konsevich's realization that the good structure is, because there would be an infinite automorphism group of this, which you wouldn't want. You'd have to divide out, you see, by a C star here. You want the set of automorphisms of all these things to be finite. That's very important.
We are already doing that, no? The other component, that still has a C star automorphism.
No, because you see, here the map is non-constant. So you've got some map U, and you're saying U is equal to U composed with phi, if you had an automorphism. So phi would have to be something that fixed these two points. And so you'd have to have phi z1 is z1. Phi of the nodal point, let's say infinity, is infinity. And it would have to satisfy this. Well, if u is non-constant, you wouldn't have you couldn't.
It's a condition, right? It could happen.
You'd only have a finite number. You see, what you could have, you could be a map. Say you could have u from, you could think of C union infinity to M, and it takes Z to, say, Z cubed. And then you could have an automorphism which took Z to e to the 2 pi I over 3 Z. That would be an automorphism, so that U of phi would equal phi. But it would be a finite group. You're not saying there aren't any automorphisms, you're saying it's a finite group of automorphisms. So if it was a multiply covered curve, it could have an automorphism. But if it's an injective curve, somewhere injective curve, so that's another thing, you have this idea of a somewhere injective curve. U from S2 to M. What that means is that there is some point Z naught such that if you look at its image, and then its pre-image, that's just Z naught. So that it's a map that here's the domain S2, here's your Z naught. On this little neighborhood, it's injective. And then you see, if it's injective there, and you have something that behaves like this, that U of phi would have to be the identity in that little neighborhood where it was injective. And that doesn't happen. If you have a Möbius transformation that fixes three points, it's the identity. So really, this stability condition, the sort of the geometric way of understanding it, is telling you that the group of automorphisms of this stable map is finite. That's what the stability condition is saying. And that's a very important condition that allows you it's the fact that you could have automorphisms means that you're actually, you know, the space here, the strata, are typically orbifolds rather than manifolds, because you could have automorphisms. So you're modeled on an orbifold. But it's very important that the finite, it's an orbifold with finite isotropic groups. Yeah.
It just occurred to me that I think you didn't say that stable maps have to have finite energy, which is what guarantees that the stability condition actually implies finite automorphism group.
Ah, okay. Well, I was saying that we're in some class A.
Right,
so then omega of A is a number, right? So they do have finite energy. But you're right. I mean, if you're doing more general things, the finiteness of the energy is actually what makes this whole compactness theorem work. You've got to have a bound on the energy, a bound on the W12 norm to get started with the analysis.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
How do you put the topology on M bar 0k?
Oh. Something called the Gromov topology, which I don't particularly want to go into. I mean, it's each stratum, it's clear enough how you topologize it. And then nearby, well, there's a structure you see when you have a stable map I have to mention this at some point if I'm doing sort of the elementary beginning anyway. If you want to know what's a neighborhood of something like this, you have to do gluing. So you have to say gluing is a way of, if you've got a nodal domain, then sort of nearby there are things which nearly have the bubbles, nearly have the nodes, but don't quite. So, you know, nearby, so here we've got two nodes. So we've got, you know, one gluing parameter here and another gluing parameter there. And for each, you know, if you have, let me get a slightly bigger board. So suppose we've got a single node. So here's we've got some map. So this, we've got, let's have no mark points just for simplicity. This is going to some line, and that's going to some line. So the non-trivial map. So this is going to a pair of lines. So the image would be a pair of lines. Well, nearby this pair of lines in CP2, you actually have, of course, a quadric. Impossible to draw. But how analytically do you see that? Well, you have this sphere. You take this sphere, and you take with minus a disk. You take that sphere minus a disk. So you've got S2 minus a disk of size epsilon. You've got another one S2 minus a disk of size epsilon, and then you sort of glue their boundaries together. You identify their boundaries so that you have something like this, right? I mean, that's what you'd smooth it out a little bit, so it's actually a sphere. When you glue their boundaries, you have a twist here. You have a theta twist. So the parameters you have here, you have an epsilon, which measures how big the disk is here, and you have a theta. So that you can think of as A as epsilon times e to the 2 pi I theta. That is in C. That's a little complex gluing parameter. So when epsilon is 0 is when you have the bubble. And when epsilon's a little bit bigger than 0, you've joined the domains together. Now, of course, in practice, what you do is you use cylindrical coordinates here, so it sort of looks like an infinite n. So you think of something looking like this and something looking like this. So you take away a point here, and you have this infinite cylindrical end. And then you chop off here at some point and join them together. And then because a map, you see, how do you get a holomorphic map here? Well, the map, you've got U1 here and U2 say, well, it's near this point, it's essentially constant. So you can just, on this glued together thing here, you just make your new map, you've got U tilde say, which is U1, U2 glued together with some gluing A. It's basically equal to U1 here, it's equal to U2 here, and then here you just patch together with some kind of bump function. You just interpolate. So this is almost holomorphic, not quite holomorphic. And then you use a Newton process to make it holomorphic. So that's an analytic thing called gluing. And again, Dietmar and I do the very, very simplest case of that in our J-holomorphic curve book. Now, gluing, you know, you can... The analysis of this is pretty well understood. It's horrible. I mean, it's real analysis, right? So if you're a topologist like me and you don't like analysis, I mean, if you're an analyst, you love it. But otherwise, it's a sort of pain that has to be survived, right? But it does exist. It is well understood. But it can be done in different contexts. And of course, in the Fredholm, in the polyfold context, they have a very beautiful way of doing the gluing. But and then that sort of gives you the topology. I mean, there is something called the Gromov topology that you can measure, which I really don't want to go into. But basically, you can take, if you have a map that's, you know, sort of where the domain sort of looks like that, you're basically, well, I'm just not, you have to rescale, you have to restrict to bits of the domain and rescale it and sort of measure it. I don't particularly want to go into that. All I want to say is a topology. Which, so you have these strata, and for each node, so if you have a stratum with one node, like consisting of elements like that, then there's a, over that, there's a line bundle consisting of the gluing parameters, and then there's a map which takes you that line bundle into sort of resolves it. So you can get a topology. Of course, the Gromov topology, you don't need the gluing, you can describe it without the gluing. Anyway, I did want to say a little bit about the regularity question.
What is the dimension of the strata?
Right.
Certain number of nodes. So you have this 2 times the number of nodes. So this 2 is just the, for each node, you have this complex parameter.
Exactly. Yeah. So that's exactly right where those parameters come from. Okay. So let me do this. But I think I should say something about regularity to justify the title of my talk. Okay, so I had the notion of a somewhere injective curve. It's actually right up here. Now, what does transversely cut out mean? Well, so we have our the Cauchy-Riemann operator, del bar j of u. Is a half of du plus j composed with du composed with little j. And this thing, well, du is a differential. So that we're thinking of as a one-form. This is a one-form on the domain with coefficients and the pullback of the tangent bundle. So it's an anti-holomorphic one-form. And du itself is a one-form. The fact that we add that to make it, it makes it anti-J-holomorphic, so it anti-commutes with J. And we can think in general. We have X as some space of maps. Perhaps I should write W1P maps from S2 into M. We've got J as a space of tame, almost complex structures. And we have a pair of elements in there. We have UJ in there. So we have, this is just a map, and that's a J. And then we have this operator. Now, this operator lives it's in a one form, but you see its image depends on U. So that means that we really have a bundle over here, E. And we're thinking of del bar J as a section of this bundle here. And the fiber of this bundle, EUJ, So for each pair uj here, we get a map in there. That's precisely the space of... And actually, if I'm completing this to W1P maps, I mean, you can do this in the C infinity case, but if you want to do Fredholm theory or something, you better put some Banach spaces here. So then this would better be the, instead of the, in, these are C infinity things, let's have the LP. Take them LP sections, because we've differentiated, so you get LP one forms. So we have this bundle here. You can prove this is a nice bundle over this space. It's a Banach bundle. You've got this operator. What we'd like to say transversely cut out is we'd like that we're interested in a zero set. And what we want is that for this, we want del bar j to be transverse to the zero section. So we want that at the solutions. So to say transverse, that means we have this operator. We can look at the linearization L of UJ, which is the linearization of this operator. I mean, this is a map from a Banach manifold to a Banach manifold, so you can differentiate it. C1 should be C1, so you can differentiate it, and then you can project onto the fiber. And using a connection in general, but along the zero set, it's well defined. And then the linearization is sort of the linearization of the... So if we evaluate that on a psi and a y, so psi is in the tangent space to the mapping space at u, and y is in the tangent space at j to the space of almost complex structures, this linearized operator takes the form, well, it's the ordinary linearization of the Cauchy-Riemann operator, where you fix J and just linearize it, and then you add to it the sort of linear term coming from varying J. Well, J actually appears here only linearly, so this is a half of Y composed with du composed with J. So you have the linearization consists of these two terms. Now, if you fix J, then, of course, this term goes out. And the transversely cut out means that duj is surjective for all u in the solution space. And then when it is, you see this operator here. If you just look at du, you fix j and look at that operator, this is a Fredholm operator. So that means it has finite dimensional kernel, has a closed range and a finite dimensional co-kernel. So to say if it's surjective, then it just has a kernel. The kernel has a fixed dimension equal to the index of the operator, and then it's an open condition that to have a surjective linearization. So there's an implicit function theorem in this Banach space context for Fredholm operators. So if it's surjective for all u here and you vary j a little bit, it'll remain surjective. So that's some kind of nice stable situation. So that's what you're looking for. And if it's surjective, that means the solution space is a manifold of the right dimension, just using the implicit function theorem. But now, what's the basic theorem in this setting? The basic theorem in this setting is that you can't, unfortunately, prove... I mean, we'd like to say that if we allow variations in J, we'd like to say that it's always a manifold. But that's not quite true. So the theorem is that if you look at M star aj, say. So this is all somewhere injective j holomorphic curves ua. I'm out of time, so I'm just going to...
I have five minutes.
Okay, well, that would be helpful. Thank you. So you look at all summer injective curves, and you allow yourself to vary J, then this is a Banach manifold. And I suppose I should, I should be a little bit more careful. JL would consist of CL, almost complex structures, because we better put ourselves in a situation of a Banach manifold, right? So we better, instead of lying C infinity J, we better complete them to be, they could be W1P, but you can or WKP, but you can make them just CL, almost complex structures. So that's a Banach space. So that's a Banach manifold. And then if you look at the map, just taking a pair UJ to U, that this is Fredholm for L large enough. Strictly, actually, perhaps it's always Fredholm, but really what I want to say is if L is large enough, there's a set sitting inside there of regular values. So that would be where the thing is transversely cut out. It's called regular if the thing is transversely cut out. And the point here is that this is a residual. In the sense of bare. Or I suppose you can say co-meager. Or if you're in the first edition of the book with Dietmar, we said of second category, but that's actually a wrong thing. That doesn't mean what we meant it to mean. But anyway, this is a large set. In other words, it's a countable intersection of dense open sets. So it's a large set, that co-meager thing. It's not open and dense itself, but it's a countable intersection of open dense things. So it means it's always non-empty, lots of stuff in it. And in fact, there's a trick of Taubes that allows you, I mean, in principle, you do this first when you have a CL thing, but you can take L equal to infinity here by some trick of Taubes. So what that's telling you, so that means then that there's a large set in here of regular J where all the solutions are regular. And so that, but the kicker here is that the curves have to be somewhere injective. You can't do this. You see, if it's a multiply covered curve, you may not be able to make it regular. The difficulty is that if you have, suppose you have U from S2 to M, and this could be regular. That one could be fine, so du could be onto. And it could be somewhere injective. But then we could take a map which is a composite of, we could take phi from S2 to itself of degree k, and then look at phi composed with u. So perhaps I should call this psi, because it's not a holomorphism. So this is a multiple covering, because this, for example, could be u at z to the k or something. Now that, if you have a regular curve that exists and you perturb J, it's going to still exist, they persist. So you may be able to have, you may not be able to, this may be a perfectly good regular curve, you perturb J, you always have u. Then you always have these multiple covers. But what's wrong with these multiple covers? The fact is that the index of this thing well, it's 2n plus 2c1 now of k times a plus whatever. Well, perhaps we don't have any marked points, so that's what it is. Now, the difficulty here is that if c1a is negative, which it certainly could be, I mean, there's no reason. In order to have the index, you see if the index of u is 2n plus 2c1 of a, and because if we're just looking at a map from a sphere into M, it always, if it exists, there's always a six-parameter family because you have all the reparameterizations. So the index of this has to be bigger than or equal to six in order for this curve to be there. But suppose you're in a dimension, you know, 2n is 10. You could suddenly have this being 10 and this n being minus 4, and so you have a curve in that class with a negative Chern class. But then you see, if you look at something like this, this thing could be so negative that this actual index could be negative. And yet this curve would always be there. You can't perturb it away because the underlying curve is always there, and therefore its multiple covers are there. So if you have a strata in the stable maps which actually contains something like this, I mean, you could have a curve in class, suppose you have a curve in class B, and then it could decompose into something of class B minus KE plus KE, where C1 of E is negative. It could decompose like that. Well, then you see, you're not going to necessarily be able to get rid of the curves in class KE. They may always exist. There could be multiple covers of curves in class E, which are allowed to exist. But then the index of this thing would be big, because you see the first Chern class here of C minus KE, well, the first Chern class of E is negative, and so the first Chern class of B minus K is bigger than the first Chern class of B. So that means you'd have a stratum, the curves in class B minus KE would, in the best situation, even if you could make them all generic, they would live in a space which has got two higher dimensions. So that means you lose control of the boundary, and therefore you can't have simple methods of getting rid of this. So that's the problem, why you can't use regular standard thing. And why you need this to be injective? Well, I don't have time. If people don't know the argument, I can explain to you. You can ask questions about. I don't have time to explain why it has to be somewhere injective here. But basically the reason is that you've got, here's your manifold, and here's where you're varying J. So when you're varying, you see you're allowed to vary J here to get regularity. But you're varying J on M. But the image of your curve, here's S2, where the domain of your map is going to some one form on S2. So you have to take your variation in J, which lives in M, and pull it back to S2. Now, if it's somewhere injective, then there's going to be a little neighborhood here. You can control it. You can control J here. If it's somewhere injective, you can pull it back and control it there. But if it's not somewhere injective, when you pull back something from here, it would have several pre-images here. And so you can't, it doesn't give you so much control over what the variations in J do for you. So really, as I explain, if it's not somewhere injective, the curve, you can really have these bad components of the compactification, that it is too big, that can't be dealt with. Now, I was going to say more about the analytic difficulties of dealing with this in the traditional way. You see, what you have to do, I'll be explaining sort of geometric regularization. You have to have more complicated variations. You have to allow yourself more complicated perturbations, which don't just depend. I mean, the perturbations I'm allowing myself here are just to vary J, which is, say, is sort of a big variation. That's just on the manifold, and you vary J on the manifold. Well, you can have much finer variations of J to correct. But then there are all kinds of problems which I luckily don't have time to get into. So there we are. Okay.
So since we have office hours this evening, I propose that long questions get asked then, but do people have any quick, shorter questions for Dusa?
Does Perturbis theorem say that the regular locus is connected?
Yes, it does. The one parameter family is because everything sort of happens in codimension two. Well, you don't actually have to know it's connected, the regular locus. What you need to know is that there's a regular family, a regular homotopies. And regular homotopies, you see, if you have a one parameter family in here, that sort of gives you an extra dimension because you've got a variation of J in one dimensional families. So you can have a one parameter family of things here, which doesn't actually consist of everywhere regular things, but consists of things where the codimension of the image is just one dimension. Right. So, yeah, the part of this theorem tells you if you have two regular values, you can find a regular homotopy in between where the inverse image would be a manifold of the right dimension.
Okay.
But you can't necessarily pass between them through regular J's.
No, you can't necessarily pass between two regular J's, because if you could, it would mean that the space of J holomorphic curves for J0 and for J1 were isomorphic, basically. Right? And basically, all you can say is that they're coordinate. For spheres, in certain situations, you can, but in many, you know, in general, you can't.
Are there more questions for Dusa? All right, let's thank Dusa for a nice introduction.